Greetings again today in the name of Jesus Christ, our wonderful Lord and Savior. Good to see you here in the auditorium in the Northside Baptist Church today. We welcome every one of you. And you that's listening out in the radio listening audience, we most certainly appreciate you tuning in to the Northside Baptist Church Hour that's coming to you live right from the auditorium of the Northside Church here in Athens, Georgia. And if you get on your phone and call a friend and have them to tune in and get this hour coming up, we'll endeavor to be a blessing to them. I feel like we can. Someone was telling me the other day about a man walking down the street and stepped on a banana peeling and slipped up, and man, he really busted the ground. And while he's getting up, a little boy ran up to him and said, "Mister," said, "would you do that again?" Said, "My mama didn't see you that time." Well, I hope that you enjoyed the service thus far, and you'll be back tonight at 6 o'clock for the evening service. And you out in the radio listening audience, if you're not getting our daily broadcast, I hope that you'll tune in each day at 12 o'clock noon and get the daily broadcast. Now, if God permits us to tell the old story through medium of radio, through the last day of this month, it'll bring to completion 37 years of daily broadcasting. That's longer than some of you have been in the world, of course. And we appreciate this open door and those that's worked with us in getting out the gospel. I hear a lot of good reports of things that's been accomplished through the radio ministry and been accomplished over the years. Some few years ago, we went up here near Brockton, and they kindly arranged an old tabernacle, had shavings on the ground there, and we kindly got it all fixed up for a meeting. Went up there and held a meeting. We had a man with us at that time, Brother Hal Dixon, the man that was foreman on the building of our church building. And we got out and prayed, and Brother Harold Dixon prayed that God would give us 25 souls in that meeting. Now, of course, that meeting was indirectly because of the radio broadcast. The radio broadcast played a great part in it, of course. And so we had a meeting, and God gave 24 souls on the last night of the meeting. And to close the meeting, the people didn't know that we had prayed for 25. Brother Dixon had prayed for 25. And was about ready to dismiss, and another individual came down the aisle weeping and said, I can't let this meeting close without me getting saved. And that person got saved, made the 25 that we prayed for. Exactly. Well, some of those people that were saved in that tabernacle came down here and joined Northside and stayed here many years. And then they wanted a church in their own community, some of the same group. So they organized the church and the community, known at that time as the Community Baptist Church, is now known as the Brockton Road Baptist Church, I believe. And there's a young man that was saved in that meeting that's now the pastor of that church. So you never know what the ministry will do, the future of the ministry. And I was greatly thrilled. Our last fellowship meeting, got up and testified and said he was saved under my ministry. And I talked with him after the service. He said he was saved in that meeting there at the tabernacle. And now pastor of the fine Brockton Road Baptist Church. So the radio ministry has meant a lot over the years. I thank God for the 37 years of broadcasting, almost 37 years. And I didn't do it alone. You that help support this work financially is just as much involved in it as I am. And I believe when we come to the judgment seat of Christ, we'll be rewarded together for all the good that's been accomplished. God's raised up people to help us take care of our radio expense. God opened the door in 1948, and God had not raised up people to help us take care of the expense, we could not have stayed on all these years. And so we thank God for this open door. And this is Radio Anniversary Month. In years gone by, we've had some to make a contribution of a dollar for each year we've been on the air, which would be 37 this year. God shall lay upon the heart of any of you out in the radio listening audience or in the auditorium that would like to make that type of contribution. It'd be used to help spread the gospel and be appreciated. Now, if you'd like to have one of our brochures for the Holy Land Tour of next year, write in and get it. Some of the people got a little shaken up about the hijackings here some time ago. Well, it's safer right now than it's ever been because they've really tightened up on security. A lot of people afraid of plane crashes. Did you know there's far more people killed by automobiles and planes? It's much safer to ride from here to New York on a plane than it is to ride from here to New York in an automobile. But a lot of people just kind of afraid to ride a plane. I enjoy it myself. I feel like that God will see us through. And so if you'd like to go on this trip, you write in and get one of our brochures. I'm not going to be making mention of it every Sunday, and boy, the people there talking about it, but I do want it known that we have the brochures. We'll be going to Israel, we'll be going to Rome, Italy, and it's a 10-day tour and a real tour of a lifetime. And you pray about it, write in for it, come by and see me, call me on the phone, let me know if you're interested. I'd be glad to work with you in this respect. Now, you can get some of our cassette tape. We have about 190 listed of our cassette tape. And you can get them. We'll send you a list of our cassette tape. We'll send them out for a gift of $3 each. Your gift is used to help defray our radio expense. Now, if you have your Bible, I want you to turn to two places in the Word of God. I want you to turn to the book of Psalms, chapter 9, which is found on page 602. Then I want you to turn to Luke chapter 16, which is found on page 1098. While you're turning there, I want to give you my mailing address. My mailing address is Virgil Edwards, P.O. Box 501, Athens, Georgia, 30603 is the zip code number. So you pray for me and write to me, and we appreciate it so very much. We have a number of our people absent today, so I'm on vacation, part of my family on vacation today, and others, and we appreciate you that are here and you that's listening out in the radio listening audience. Now in Psalms chapter 9 and verse 17, I will read, and I want you to pray for this message. God's laid it on my heart. God knows who he wants to get this message in the radio listening audience. God knows who he wants to get the message here in the auditorium. And Psalms chapter 9 and verse 17, the wicked shall be turned into hell, and all the nations that forget God. Now, God wrote the Bible. I didn't write it. God put in the Bible what he wanted in there. And he said, the wicked shall be turned into hell and all the nations that forget God. Now, in Luke chapter 16, beginning with verse 19, there was a certain rich man which was clothed in purple and fine linen and fed sumptuously every day. There was a certain beggar named Lazarus, which was laid in his gate full of sores, and desired to be fed with the crumbs which fell from the rich man's table. And he cried and said, Father Abraham, have mercy on me, and send Lazarus that he may dip the tip of his finger in water and cool my tongue, for I am tormented in this flame. But Abraham said, Son, remember that thou in thy lifetimes receivest thy good things, and likewise Lazarus evil things. But now he is comforted and thou art tormented. And beside all this, between us and you, there's a great gulf fixed. So they which have passed from hence to you cannot, neither can they pass to us that would come from thence. And he said, I pray thee therefore, Father, thou wouldst send him to my father's house. For I have five brethren that may testify unto them, lest they also come into this place of torment. Abraham saith unto him, they have Moses and the prophets, let them hear them. And he said, Nay, Father Abraham, but if one went unto them from the dead, they will repent. And he said unto him, if they hear not Moses and the prophets, neither will they be persuaded, though one rose from the dead. Now that's reading from Luke chapter 16, verses 19 through 31. I'm speaking to you on this subject, the torments of hell. Now you may say, Preacher Edwards, I don't believe in hell. Well, that doesn't change it. Somebody might say to me, Preacher Edwards, I don't believe in a place called Athens, Georgia. Do you think that would bother me because of their ignorance? No, sir, there is a place called Athens, Georgia. Someone says, I don't believe in hell, I don't believe in heaven, it's not going to change it because of their ignorance. Now, the ignoramus might make that statement, but God's word is true and every man's a lie. And because some people don't believe in hell, doesn't change it. Now, this narrative I read to you here is not a parable. Nowhere in the Bible did Jesus ever call a man's name in a parable. This actually happened. Jesus said there was a certain rich man. There was a man named Lazarus. And so this is not a parable. Now you do have these Nohelites, these Russellites trotting around today, sending out their poison literature that deny the fact of hell. But beloved, they're ignorant. They've been led astray by false prophets and false teachers. And they will be in hell 1 second before they realize there is a literal burning hell and hell fire. But it'll be too late. It's mentioned 31 times in the Old Testament. And it's mentioned 21 times in the New Testament by Jesus Christ himself alone. Now Jesus Christ mentioned hell more than all the other New Testament writers put together. And if Jesus Christ mentioned hell, he knows something about it because he's the one that created hell. And he tells us about hell. And we know there is a hell just as certain as there's a heaven where saved people go, there's a hell where wicked, ungodly, lost people go. God can never and will never let people live together after this life that are wicked and godly. Let them live together. The weak is going to be in one place. The godly will be in another. And it's certain that there's a heaven, there is a hell. If you're going to deny hell, you might as well deny heaven. Now there's a hell to shun and a heaven to gain. And according to the Bible, there's some torments in hell. And by the way, this is tape number 191. Tape number 191, the torments of hell. There's some torments in hell that I want to mention today, and I want you to listen. There may be somebody in the radio listening audience that's almost in hell right now. Only your rib cage between you and hell, and when your soul leaves your body, you plunge into hell, and that'll be it. Maybe somebody very near death that don't know God. And God Almighty will never let one soul go to heaven unsaved. If God lets one soul go to heaven unsaved, then every inmate in hell would rise up and point his finger toward God and say, "You're an unjust God. You let so-and-so in and you didn't let me in." So God's made it plain and clear that there's a hell and there's a heaven. Then God made it doubly plain and clear there's a way that you can know how to get to heaven and escape hell. It's very clear in the Word of God. Now people have an idea that they can go on and live like the devil and live in sin, unsaved. And just before they die, God perform a miracle and save them and carry them on to heaven and be glad to get them. Now, don't kid yourself. People die like they live. If you have 90% of the people a day living for the devil and 10% living for God, then you have 10% going to heaven and 90% going to hell. God is not working miracles at the moment of death in that respect in a wholesale manner. There's a few that get saved on their deathbed, but very few. Now there was a test made and some men checked up on some that made a profession of faith on their deathbed when they thought they were dying. And most of them that thought they were dying that got well and did not die, did not live for God at the profession. They made a profession because they was afraid it wasn't genuine. Had it been genuine, they'd have continued on for God after they got well, but they did not. Now, a person must be saved. He's headed for the torments of hell. And torment number one, we find to be truth realized too late. The truth of hell, the truth of heaven, the truth of the immortality of man. Now, a lot of people have different ideas about life and death and religion and hell and heaven and about hereafter. But when people die and go to hell, they're going to realize there's a hell. There's a truth of it in the Bible. And that'll be a great torment to them when they realize too late there's a hell. And when they realize too late that they'll miss heaven, that'll be another torment. And then when they realize the immortality of man, that they must live forever without God and never get a chance to go to heaven. Now, there's no such thing in the Bible as purgatory. That's a lie of the devil in the rags of Rome. Now, when you die, you go straight to hell or straight to heaven in a matter of seconds. The devil has a lot of people believing there's a place called purgatory, where when you die, you'll go have your sins purged, and then you'll be let out and go to heaven. The devil has a lot of people today believing that you can be baptized for the dead and and there they'll come out of hell and go to heaven. Not a word of that soul. When you die, you go to your eternal abode. You go to hell or heaven. Now, at the end of the millennium, of course, hell will be belched up and the inmates will come out and be judged and sent to the lake of fire. They'll never have a chance to go to heaven or have a second chance to be saved. Number two, a second torment of hell will be unsatisfied desires. Have you ever been real thirsty? Have you ever seen people real thirsty and then managed to get some water? And how that they appreciated that water? It's awful to be thirsty and can't get water. Most of us, we have plenty of water and we don't usually get thirsty. We have some kind of beverage to drink and we make it all right. But just think about having a desire for water and can't get water. This poor old rich man was begging for just one drop of water. That's one of the torments of hell. People in hell can't get water. They can't get one drop. He said, just let Lazarus go and dip his finger in water and just put one drop on my tongue. Just a drop. If I could get just a drop of water. Down in hell, there's no water. There's heat and flame there and no water. No way to get water. And the inmates of hell are begging and pleading for water down there, but no water will be given them. There's no water in hell, and there's no mercy in hell. Now you can have mercy on individuals and God have mercy on people on the earth, but when you go to hell, there's no mercy. Nobody will have any mercy on you whatsoever. Not even God, not Jesus Christ, not the Holy Spirit, not the people of God, because there's nothing to do about it. You're there without mercy. And then, of course, there's no relief from pain in hell. He said, I'm tormented in these pains. I'm tormented in the flame. That's pain down there in hell. Now, you know how it hurts and how you have terrible pain just to touch a fire and burn your finger or some part of your body. Now, think about people. They're wrapped up in flames in hell and all of that pain and nothing to ease that pain. Not a thing in the world. That's part of the torments in hell. There's no ease for pains. Down here, you can have a pain in your body. You might be able to secure something that alleviates that pain temporarily, and you won't have to suffer from it. But in hell, there's no relief from pain whatsoever. I can't understand why sinners are going and live in sin and knowing that they may drop off in hell just any minute. The devil tells them they'll never go to hell, but they will go to hell if they don't get saved. And most of them will die and go there without God, I'm sorry to say. Torment number three, we find to be the flames in hell. In verse 24, I am tormented in this flame. Tormented in this flame, the Bible tells us. There's flame in hell. One of the world's most outstanding leading evangelists today, I'm not saying he's God's man, I'm just saying he's the world's leading evangelist today. He done put the fire of hell out. He doesn't believe in the fire and hell. Of course, he's teaching false doctrine. And that's the reason the world's leading evangelist. He spread out so thin he covers nothing and compromised and went along with the religious crowd and left God. And so he doesn't believe in hell fire anymore. These liberals, these infidels, don't believe in hell fire. The modernists don't believe in a literal burning hell. But God's people believe it. Fundamental preachers believe it. God's men believe it, and they preach it. But the liberals don't. Now, every man in hell will have a place, the Bible tells us. The word of God said Judas Iscariot went to his own place. There's punishment in hell and flame in hell. The inmates of hell are literally being wrapped up in flame down in the bowels of this earth. Now, you may say, Preach Edwards, where is hell? Hell is in the bowels of this earth, right down in the heart of this great planet. That's why hell is right now. It won't be there forever. At the great white throne judgment of God, at the end of the millennium, God will take every lost soul out of hell and they'll be judged and cast into the lake of fire. We have no way to prove this, but someone said the sun is that lake of fire. The Bible doesn't say that, but we know the sun's terribly hot. And so they will be cast into a lake of fire. Torment number four would be the memory that you carry with you to hell if you die and go there. The Bible says in verse 25, but Abraham said, Son, remember. Now this rich man lived on the earth. He had his heart's desire. But when he died and went to hell, he carried with him his memory. Esau thought about the good things he had upon the earth. Father Abraham said, remember the good things you had and Lazarus' evil things. Everybody in hell today is thinking about the good things and how they had it good on the earth, many of them. They're thinking about that down in hell. And they think about the evil things they did while they was on earth. Now, one reason they're thinking so much about the evil is they probably know that when they move from hell, they'll be moved to the judgment seat of the bar of God, the great white throne judgment. And there they'll be judged according to their evil deeds to determine their degree of punishment. Not the time element, but the degree of punishment in the lake of fire. And so they're thinking about those evils. Take a man like Adolf Hitler, responsible for some maybe 60, 65 million deaths of people during World War II, and how he'll stand there before God at the judgment bar of God and the blood of all those people on his hands, 6 million Jews included, and the suffering and the anguish that he caused people on the earth. Hell will be terrible. Lake of fire will be terrible for Adolf Hitler, old Joe Stalin, and all the wicked of the world. Hell will be terrible for them. And so they'll remember that, and they know, Hitler who's in hell will know, that one day he must stand at the great white throne and be judged for starting World War II and causing all those deaths. In Italy, after they found Adolf Hitler dead, and it's proven fact that he was dead, somebody said to another, said, well, old Adolf Hitler's still alive. He said, you don't believe he's dead? He said, no. He said, he's still alive, and he's down in hell screaming down there. Well, that man told the truth. He's alive in the flames of a burning hell today with all the people that died without God. Now, the Bible says the dogs came and licked the sores of poor old Lazarus. He was a poor man, body emaciated, filled with sores, no money, no bread, no medicine. And the poor old dogs had more mercy on him than the rich man did. They came and licked his sores. Somebody said a dog had healing virtue in his tongue. I don't know how true that is. But he licked Lazarus' sores to help ease his pain. The old dogs had more mercy on him than the rich man did. Somebody cared for poor old Lazarus. The dog licked his sores. And that shows you the love of God that somebody cares. And he received maybe a little comfort. And he was not expected to go to the torments of hell. He was tormented on the earth. Somebody said, well, the only hell you'll ever have is here on the earth. Don't be quite so ignorant. The Bible brands that as a liar. If you believe that, you believe a liar. The Bible said there's a hell. Now somebody says, war is hell, war is hell. No, that's not true either. War is bad, but war is not hell. There's no place on this earth like hell down in the heart of the earth. And people don't have their hell on earth. They have trouble and torment. And the Bible said the wicked, like the troubled sea, always cast up dirt and mire. And they create many times their own suffering. But beloved, it's not hell. You don't get your hell here on the earth as a sinner. Now the only heartaches and disappointments and torments and agony a Christian will receive is here on the earth. Because when he leaves this world, he's going to a better one. The only good that any poor sinner will ever receive is right here on the earth. He breathes God's good air, drinks God's water, eats God's food, wears clothing God gives him money to gain wealth to buy. He enjoys the pleasure of this world, and that's the only enjoyment he'll ever have. When he dies, he'll open his eyes in the flames of a terrible hell without any comfort and be tormented. That's why he's going at death. In a matter of seconds after he dies, he'll end up in hell according to the Bible. Then the next great torment, number 5, will be the great gulf. Now, what is meant by that is there's no escape. The Bible says in verse 26, beside all this between us and you, that's a great gulf fixed. So they which would pass from his to you cannot, neither can they pass us that would come from this. Now, hell is a place of darkness. Hell is a place of a great gulf between hell and paradise. At the time that this man died, and at the time that Lazarus died, paradise was in the heart of the earth. All people went down into the heart of the earth before Calvary. And so Lazarus went down there also. And he went to Abraham's bosom. The paradise of God is called Abraham's bosom. And he went to Abraham's bosom, and across that great gulf was hell. the fire where the rich man went, where he's tormented. And he wanted something done. He wanted Lazarus to come over and do something for him. He could see Lazarus over in Abraham's bosom. But there was a great gulf fixing. There's no way that Lazarus or anybody could cross that gulf. Neither could anybody out of hell cross over into paradise. And there was a great gulf. Now, no way out. Now you have people today that are sentenced to prison and maximum security, and they are put in there for terrible crimes, but many of them manage to escape. They have some hope of getting out or escaping or someday or another getting out of prison. But when a person dies and goes to hell, there's no hope whatsoever. There are some prisoners today that have such a sentence that they know there's no way of them ever getting released lawfully, but they hope some way or another they might be able to escape. They have just a little ray of hope. But down in hell, there's no hope whatsoever. Down there, they know they can't escape. They know they'll never get out. It's a place of darkness. It's a place of torment, and they have no comfort and no mercy down there. Torment number 6, we find to be the oncoming brothers. In verses 27 and 28, then he said, I pray thee therefore, Father, that I would send him to my father's house. If I have 5 brethren, they may testify unto them, lest they also come to this place of torment. Here's a man that's concerned about his 5 lost brothers. And he knew they were on the way. Now, why wasn't he concerned about his mother and daddy? They were probably down there with him. I don't think they were in heaven in Abraham's bosom had he said so, probably. And because if a man and woman saved got 6 children, they should at least touch maybe at least one of them for God. And he was concerned about his 5 lost brothers. And that's one of the greatest torments in hell today. His mothers and dads down there screaming in the flames of hell, and they know they left their loved ones here lost. And they know their loved ones will soon be there if somebody don't win them to God. And that's one of the great torments of hell. There's a man in Atlanta, Georgia one time, a young boy in the hospital. Jess Henley told this story many years ago. He said this boy's father visited his son in the hospital. His son had contracted venereal disease, is bringing him out of the world. He's about ready to die. And when his daddy walked into that room, his daddy was a drunkard and a weakened man. He followed his daddy's footsteps. He pointed his finger toward his daddy. He said, I'm dying and going to hell, and you're to blame for it. And he died and went to hell. Isn't that an awful thing? Down in hell today, there's boys, there's young men pointing fingers at their dads and their mothers and said, if you'd have got right with God and lived right and trained us right and told us right and wrong and led us to God, we wouldn't be here. Hell is a madhouse. And everybody in hell today is concerned about somebody that's on the way to hell. They believe in prayer down there. They believe in missions. They have compassion, but it's too late to do anything about it. There's people on the earth that laugh at you about your Bible and going to church and prayer meetings and missions and having compassion and mercy, but they're not laughing in hell. They're doing some praying down there. They're doing some pleading, some begging. And they have lost loved ones on the way there, and they don't want to see them. They hope they'll never lay their eyes on them again, because they know if they ever see them again, it'll be in hell, and don't want to see them. They want them to get saved and go on to heaven. They know they'll never lay eyes on them anymore, that they'd be in heaven. But if they die and go to hell, they're going to fall in with them, and such cursing and raving and false accusations and carrying on, you never heard the like. That hell is a madhouse. The Bible lets us know hell is a madhouse. They go there, they're mad, they're angry, and it's terrible. The next torment I want to mention, number 7, is the wicked themselves. Who are they? Now, hell is a madhouse. Hell is a prison house. Hell is a crazy house. And down there, they're mad at each other. They're cursing one another. And all the wicked, the scum of the earth, is in hell. People died without God. Murders, drunkards, gangsters, robbers, thieves, all kind of wicked people. The infidels, the liberals, the modernists and whatnot, in hell screaming. And to be down there with that awful mob. It's hard enough to live on this earth among wicked people. That it's getting more wicked every day. Now think about going to hell and having to be with them forever. That'd be enough to drive you to God.
to know you're going to hell and have to live with people down there that cursed and stole and lied and cheated and robbed and killed and had no mercy. And down in hell, they're screaming and cursing and carrying on. It's awful. Would you like to go to hell and live with a man like Charles Manson, Mad Dog Manson, that had no mercy and murdered people? That's the kind of people you live with. How about the mad dogs that kill the Allday family down in the western part of Georgia? And that's such trash as that, such wicked people, that's what you're going to live with in hell. All the drunks and the cusses and the gamblers, that's the kind of people that you'll be in hell. That'll be your society. That'll be your group down there. Who wants to go down there and live with that wicked, ungodly crowd? I don't. It's hard enough to live among wicked people on this earth, let alone people that die and go to hell. In Baldwin, Georgia, some years ago, in the early years of my ministry, I was up there in a meeting. A lady told me there was a wicked man that lived in Baldwin at that time, and this has been almost 40 years ago. And she said he cursed and there blasphemed and said he didn't believe in hell and the Bible and didn't believe in God. And said on his deathbed, he began to scream. He said, "I'm on fire." I said, "I'm on fire, burning, I'm burning, I'm burning." Began to scream. And they had to hold him down in his bed to keep him jumping off the bed and running over the house. He said, "I'm in fire." And said he finally died, and said when he died, his body was almost hot. It was such heat in his body until you could hardly lay your hands on it. That's a man that felt the flames of hell before his soul ever left his body. I had my tent in Crawford, Georgia many years ago. A lady came to me after the tent meeting one night, and she said, "Preach Edwards, not too long ago," he said, "there was a person that lived here," and said the person was a church member, but he wasn't saved. And said that person came to die, and he's on his deathbed, he began to scream, "I'm going to hell." He said, "Demons in this room, demons are here, demons are going to get me. I'm dying, I'm going to hell." I said, that poor man died screaming, "I'm going to hell." Out here on College Avenue several years ago, when Brother Eberhard built that Baptist church on College Avenue, there's a man that lived not too far from there that cursed that church and didn't believe in God and didn't believe in hell. And on his deathbed, he died shortly after he raved and cursed and carried on against the church. And he died pulling his pillow over his face, screaming, "My bed's on fire. I'm burning. I'm going to hell. I'm going to hell." And the man died and dropped off into hell. Now, you can laugh and scoff and mock and make light of hell and use it as a byword if you want to. Hell is an awful place. And you don't have to go there. Jesus Christ has done everything he's going to do to keep you out. And you can be saved and go to heaven, or you can just go on like you're going and die and go to hell. It's left entirely up onto the individual. God's not going to force himself on you. God's done all he's going to do. Now you do what you're going to do. You either get saved and go to heaven or die and go to hell. It's left up to the individual. Hell is a terrible place. Let's stand our feet. Dear Father, I pray today that you'll take the message and use it. Save somebody that's near hell out in the radio listen audience. God, for somebody lost in this building on the road to hell, Father, save them. We don't want them to go to hell. Lord God, we have loved ones and friends on the road to hell. We don't want them to go there, Father. We'd like for them to get saved. We pray that you'll use this message today. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Debbie's going to play for us on the organ, and she plays. If you're in this building unsaved, without God, backslidden, and you want to join this church, you want to come forward, I urge you to come now while she plays on the instrument. Will you do it? If you're lost, I wouldn't walk out that door without God. It's too dangerous. You could drive out that highway and somebody could hit you and you'd be in hell in a matter of seconds. I've known people leave my services, die before they got home. Many of them have left my services over the years and never heard another gospel message. I'm not trying to scare you. I'm giving you cold facts. You can accept them or reject them. Hell's a reality and so is heaven. It's entirely up to you as to what you do with Jesus, which is the Christ, the Savior, as to where you spend eternity. If God is speaking, will you come? Would you come? Thank you.